So I guess we'll start off. If you could please tell us your name and your profession.
My name is Dr. Richard Kelsey. I earned the name of Mareba Kelsey, so many people across the nation know me as Mareba, or Elder Mareba. My profession was a counselor educator at Ohio State, licensed psychologist, and I'm most proud of being an African licensed psychologist by the Association of Black Psychologists. So those are my professions officially. Perhaps you'd like to know that my unofficial title was African Community Organizer.
Yes, and we'll be asking you about that a little more. Before that though, I do want to ask you, could you please describe your military experience?
I was in World War II, and I actually went to World War II with the intention of becoming a Tuskegee Airman. Upon arriving, they put me in a category that they called a pre-aviation cadet to wait an opening. And I waited for doing other things for 2.5 years. And so I served in what was then the Army Air Corps, is now the Air Force, but it was before it was the Air Force. The Air Force was a part of the Army, and it was called Army Air Corps. So I served with them as a mechanic and a gunner, gunner instructor, primarily at Tyndall Field, Florida, but I also went to the Pacific, and I was in Honolulu and Manila for a period of time.
I see.
If you want to know the years, it was 1943 to 1946.
I see. And can you talk to, I'm looking at my notes, and you mentioned when we talked the segregated army and doing cleanup duties. Could you talk a little bit about your experience as a Black soldier?
Well, I belonged to all the army at the time that I was there was segregated. I was on at station for the longest time at Tyndall Field in a squadron of 164 men, and all Black men on a segmented corner of Tyndall Field, Florida. And we all were there primarily as a cleanup squadron. Now, fortunately, I had an opportunity to learn gunnery, and I became what was classified as an expert gun, expert. And so I had a chance to do some things with that. But beyond that, the full responsibility of the squadron was more or less a cleanup and keep the planes clean and oiled and those types of things.
I see, thank you. So then I'm gonna move forward in time a little bit and ask you about your relationship to Ohio State University and whether or not you were working there in 1971. And I guess what your memories of OSU are from that time period.
Yeah, I got my PhD from Ohio State, for a period of time and in Washington what was then the American Personnel and Guidance Association, which was the Association for school counselors. And then I came back to Ohio State, I think in 1970, I think it was 1970. And was employed as a counselor educator in the College of Education, and I remained there for until 1988, which time I retired from Ohio State. I had a good experience at Ohio State, and of course, race was very important on Ohio State's campus, and opportunities were somewhat limited. But we struggled through, many of us struggled through something we call the Black, Ohio State Black staff and professors. And one of the things that happened during that period of time is how I happened to meet Charles Ross, because he was over in Black as the chairman of Black Studies. And so he came to one of the meetings where we had Black personnel, Ohio State meetings. That was not a popular meeting, I might add. In fact, the colleges didn't want us to have it, but we had it anyway, until there was some disagreement among ourselves, I guess, is how it all happened to dissipate.
I see. And so before we get into Charles Ross, I do want to ask you, in general, at that time, what was the climate at Ohio State? What was happening? Was there a lot of unrest in 70, 71? You know, what was happening on the campus?
Well, there was I don't know if you call it unrest. The essentially the same climate existed across the city for Black people, and the opportunity was not as great for Black people at Ohio State as they were for others. And the promotion was not as open to Blacks as it was to others. So I think we all were conscious of that. Sometimes we didn't want to accept the fact that was true, but it was true. And that's part of the reason why it was necessary to have Black professors and staffs meeting together to decide how we were going to behave and respond to what was happening on the Ohio State's campus.
Were there a lot of student demonstrations at the time? I have, in doing the photo research, you know, there are quite a few photographs of demonstrations on campus, but also a heavy police and it seemed paramilitary presence as well.
Yes. In fact, just before I came on campus, there had been a real demonstration, a very strong demonstration, and that had to take place in order for any movement to occur, and all. In fact, as Black faculty and staff met together, that was always a question on the table. What do we need to do next in order to make progress? And so we decided, and those decisions were made sometimes popular, sometimes not, or most times not popular. So I would say that a lot of the movement that you read about that took place in the 70s and 80s had to do with that organization on campus that would demonstrate and would sometimes confront the deans and the administration of the university, including the president. It brought some considerable unrest, and people who thought that things were going well out in the community often were very astounded when we tell stories about what was happening on campus.
I see. Now, could you tell us how you came, how you came to meet Charles Ross, and also, I guess, talk more about your memories of him as a person?
Yeah. Well, I got to know him pretty well. And we started, my knowledge of him first started when we were meeting on campus with Black staff and professors. And he was very vocal in terms of his positions about race and what we needed to do, and very articulate in presenting And that's that was one of the things that that was that got him, I think, the reputation, because he was very vocal, very outspoken about it, and very accurate in almost all cases about what he was would be talking about. Didn't mind demonstrating, and of course that was very different. His manner was different from the tenor of most of the Black professors on campus. And so it was hard to keep a unity among us because there was such a resistance to things that Ross would say about what needed to be done in order to make progress. It was a blessing to have him, because much of what has happened in subsequent years might not have happened had it not been for a voice like Ross. And of course, I'll just stop there for a moment.
Okay, well, I was gonna ask you if you could be a little more specific about how his voice and his approach differed than from the other Black professors and faculty at the time.
Well, from striking to demonstration to articles written to confrontations with the administration, all of those things were part of the repertoire that Ross presented to us, and I think that that was very useful. As far as I know, he never did any damage to anything other than with his voice, but he was not perceived to be that way. He was always categorized as being a nuisance and whatnot. As I look back, I think that without the energy that he put forth, many of us would not have made progress. Many of us would not have stood up for our rights, even those who got much of the popularity as a result of the action that was taken in the early 70s. So demonstrations in the community and outside of the Ohio State, Ross didn't mind being a part of that.
Okay, so then I would like to ask you about the work that you and Mr. Ross did together in the community, and also ask you about advising students at Linda McKinley High School and whether there are particular students that you remember. I know that when we talked, I have a note here that you mentioned John Wells and Valora Washington, Zola Diggs. I wondered if there were others that you remember also.
Well, I knew I got to know the Tom Brown, students. I don't know if I knew so many students. Now we met and we would meet with students. We had a Black study class out in the community. And we would get that met on Friday evening most of the time. And we would talk about things that were going on in the school and the need for African education to be in the schools. And we would offer some books and we early in the process we didn't do this, but later on we began to invite experts from across the nation to come to speak to our study groups and to speak on campus as well whenever we could get that approved. But even if they didn't speak on campus, they speak in the community. Now, I'm aware of the fact that many students were not aware of African education at all until they attended these various study classes and discussions that we would have in the community. So many began to be inspired by that. And some of the ones that I mentioned, John Wells and Patricia Parham and so forth, people like that, began to be stimulated by that. And so I'd say that was, if I had to say it, the spark was Ross. I like to, my task in that, and when Ross was finished, was to do organizing. And so I did that reasonably well, so much so until some of the organizations are still in existence there in Columbus.
I see. Can you talk about, so I'm gonna go forward in 1971, and on May 24th, the Black students, the majority of Black students at Lyndon McKinley High School went on a march to Franklin Park to a rally that was to commemorate Malcolm X's birthday. Were you there for that? And can you talk about that experience?
Oh, that was an exhilarating experience. Students were, that was exciting, I'd say. Now, I wasn't a speaker, but I had many conversations with students who were in attendance there, students and others who were in attendance there. And they all were charged up with, what do we do next? Now, some of the planning for what took place at Lyndon McKinley, I was not a part of some of the detailed planning of that later, but I helped to organize some of the students off campus, and that's how I got to know some of them, and that's how I became a part of May 24th activity there in Franklin Park. It was an agreed on decision that the flag needed to be attended to. It was agreed on decision that we no longer should accept the fact that we didn't get African education in our curriculum. And so those are the types of discussions that were going on. I know that during that time, right after that time anyway, there were those who accused some of us as leaders as stimulating ideas about destruction. There were no ideas discussed about destruction. The ideas were about what do we do about making sure that we have some African education in our schools. And how will we demonstrate that we're serious about that? And one of them had to do with the flag.
Okay, so could you talk a little bit more about that, about your and or Ms. Ross's involvement in switching the flag outside of Lyndon McKinley, and just, you know, whatever you remember about that?
Yeah, well, I don't think that Ross was present, and I know I wasn't present at the actual climbing of the flagpole. We all heard and knew about it and got full descriptions of what happened. But I know I wasn't present. I don't think Ross was present. But the work that we had done both in the community study groups and in the park led to that action being taken. Now, the next day when the, well, I'll stop there. I don't know if that responds.
No, that's great. And if you want to go on, because I was going to ask you about, you know, how you and Charles Ross came to be at Lyndon McKinley the next day, and what happened, what you remember about the police raid and, or the assembly, and then the police raid, and then Mr. Ross's arrest.
Okay. Well, as I indicated to you, I was pretty well known in the community for organizing. At the church that I went to, Rice Memorial Bethany Presbyterian Church, I knew the pastor and his wife, and they knew that I was active in working with students there at Lyndon. And so when that event occurred, I think it was 25th of May, I believe. The I got a call from the pastor's wife. My wife told me I shouldn't call their names, so I'm not doing that. But I got a call from the pastor's wife to go and pick up, if I would go and ask me if I would go and pick up her daughter, who is now PhD herself in Texas. And I did. Well, I was just coming. I happened to be coming out of Arps Hall, going to pick up Patty Parham was the name. Going to pick up Patty, and Ross happened to be coming in the parking lot at the same time. And I told him where I was going, and he said, "I can't go right now, but I'll be there." So I went. I left ahead of him, going to Linda McKinley, and upon arriving there. Shortly after arriving there, Ross drove up and he came into the assembly. And of course, the students were not being allowed to express themselves. They were being directed to shut up or sit down and be quiet while they listened to something. And Ross spoke up and said, "Let the students speak." Well, then we had orders to leave the assembly. And until this day, there was no disruption whatsoever on the part of the students or the guests that were in that assembly. Everybody left that assembly, but as we started out in the hall, the police obviously had been called, and they were pushing students around and manhandling them. And Tom Brown and a few other staff were insisting that they stop. And Ross and I were leaving with Patty Parham. As I was talking to Ross, he was literally snatched away from our conversation, and they passed him down the hall to the. And when I asked what was happening, he said he's being arrested for trespassing. Now I thought that part of the charges was trespassing and disruption and causing a riot and those type of things. I can say to you that Ross had nothing to do with that. He didn't know that was happening. He would not have been there had I not met him in the parking lot of Arps Hall. That's how he happened to go to the assembly in the first place. And he was leaving in peace. Unfortunately, that was not the way the police saw it. In fact, the matter that I've often said, and I may have said to you before, that I think it was a setup for when he appeared for him to be arrested. And I think I might have been arrested that day, except that I didn't have on African, I wasn't wearing an African garb that particular day. And so they snatched him because he had on the dashiki. And they identified him, and he was more high profile than I. So most of the police, members of the police force or the local police force in that area knew him. My area of concentration was in the Linden area, in the Livingston area more than in the Linden area. So
I see. And let me ask you really quickly, why did Patty Parham's mom ask you to go pick her up?
Her father, who was a pastor, was out of town. And she said she had, and I had also said to her that I would watch for any trouble that may arise. And if there was anything that they would want me to do, call me. And I don't know if her father had been in town, I think I might not have been there, neither Ross either. But that's how I happened to be called.
I see. So let me ask you also, did you know Vice Principal Tom Brown or the Black Studies teachers, Bruce Bunch or Gary Davis? And if you did, what memories do you have of them, either on that day or just in general?
Well, I know Tom Brown and Bruce Bunch best. I knew Gary Davis, I didn't know. But I actually saw Tom Brown on that day trying to stop the students from being abused. And I think, I know that that's why he was arrested. He went at, upon leaving, he had not been arrested when I left, but he was in the process of trying to make sure that the students, the Linden students, were not being abused and manhandled and so forth. I saw that from him before I left. And as a result, that's how he happened to be arrested. And Bruce Bunch was doing some of the same thing. I didn't see Gary Davis that day. I knew him very well, but I didn't see him that day.
I see. And can you talk about the significance of their presence at Linda McKinley at that time? You know, not just that day, but just at that time in general.
I can. Each of them, all three of them, had been a part of the Black of an organization we call Black Educators in the community. And we talked about abusive things that were occurring in the schools. And I think that they were very attuned to do something about it. And I think they were quite surprised that the police would come in and be as abusive as they were toward the students, because most students, nothing was being destroyed. Students were leaving. I said they were boisterous, but in terms of destruction, nothing was happening. In terms of, not that I saw that was happening. None of the school's property was being damaged. It was only that they were boisterous, like high school students generally are often when they're in the hall. So Bruce Bunch and Tom Brown especially were very adamant about them being treated fairly, and that's how they both were arrested.
And what was the, how would you characterize the scene when you were leaving after Charles Ross had been snatched away by the police? What was it like? Was it chaos? Was it calming down? What was going on?
It was chaos, but I've been asked this for over the years, but it was chaos, but no property destruction was taking place. No teacher was being harmed that I'm aware of. And students were rowdy in the hallways, going wherever they were going, some to the classroom, some leaving. Some did leave. But if I were administrator in that situation, I would have said students handled themselves very well under the conditions in which they were operating. Property would have been destroyed because students were very, very capable of doing that, but they didn't. And so the manhandling and so forth that the police were doing was unnecessary and not inconsistent with what they have been doing ever since and before.
Right. Because that was my next question. I was gonna ask you how the police were interacting with the students, and I'm quite sure that contributed to, you know, the vibes going on. I want to backtrack a little bit and ask you, who was Nomo X?
Nomo was the chairman for the AfroSet, the Columbus chairman for AfroSet. The headquarters of the AfroSet was in Cleveland, but Nomo was the chairperson for the AfroSet and which was an activist group, very much an activist group in Columbus. I would say this, that if the AfroSet had been at Linden that day, then things would have been, a different report would have come out. I mean, policemen would not have been greeted as gently as they were.
I see. Okay, so I'm gonna move forward a little bit to the hearing, Charles Ross's hearing, and ask you, first of all, did you feel that the House Bill 1219 hearing was fair, and why or why not? And also, were you asked to testify since you were there at the time of the, you know, the incident in question?
No, I'll answer the last one first. I was not asked to testify. In fact, the matter is, many of those hearings were held in secret in the day when it was at a time when most people could not attend, and at places that where a lot of people didn't know about. So a lot of that was unfair, and I hope that if you've ever talked with any other person, I hope they made it clear too that you had to find out the best you could about where they were being held and what hour they were being held. And sometimes I think that Ross didn't know until the last minute.
I see. And just in general, did you feel like it was fair or no?
No. Yeah, that's an easy question. No, absolutely. They were not fair. In fact, the whole snatching of Ross was not fair because Ross had done no more than the most that Ross had done in that meeting that day was to say, let the students speak.
And that was
mild for him to do only that, but but he didn't make any big, high energy speech that particular day.
I see. And so we spoke with Peter Simmons, who was a law professor at Ohio State at the time, and he represented Charles Ross in the hearing along with William Kunstler. And he stated that essentially the legislation that was being used against Charles Ross pertained specifically to activities on OSU's campus or an area that's adjacent. And so Simmons' argument was that it did not apply to Ross's activities at Linda McKinley High School. So were you aware of that? Would you agree, I guess, that the statute was being misapplied? And if so, why do you think that was?
Well, they had there could be no charge against Ross from that day. That's if I can emphasize nothing more. That particular day, Ross was as gentle as one can be under the circumstances that existed. There was not any profanity being used. There was no loud bellowing and no attempt to take over the mic. There was no attempt to do anything. And when asked to leave, we all were leaving. So I've often said they had to trump up some charge to make it be legitimate that they look like it was legitimate for them to be snatched. In fact, it may have been that they were going to get Ross anyway, and he just made it convenient by being in that crowd that day. And because there were so many, the leadership at OSU and the city were dissatisfied with Ross's challenge to what existed, the conditions that existed at OSU and in the city for that matter.
I see. And do you remember his court case after the hearing? Do you remember his court case at all?
No, I didn't. I was not
okay.
A part.
Okay, so then I would like to ask you, did the events that happened at Linda McKinley High School in 1971 leave an impact on the city? And if so, how?
Well, I think that until this day, it has left an impact. And I would tell you After that incident at Linden, there were three that were within the next 3 years, there were three African independent schools that were started. The first one was Moja Sasa, a guy whose name is Lubin Gula, started that. And my son went to it, it was an early childhood program. And it lasted about 3 years. The second one was I want to say Uhuru Sasa. That's not right. Harambe Uhuru, and that's the one that Charles Ross led, and it was also early childhood up to maybe the third grade or thereabout, and it lasted probably 3 years, and then that was one that each one teach one, that was started by a sister, I can't think of her name right, Nzinga, I can't think of her last name, but anyway, it went on for a little longer than 3 or 4 years. And then shortly thereafter, the African Center, I don't know in your research whether you ran into this or not, but the African Center for Study and Worship, which really was a community program designed for open brainstorming and discussion and study groups for both adults and youth, and a place where food and so forth was passed out, was started on Livingston Avenue, and that lasted for maybe 6 or 7 years. Out of that, which now you see standing there in Columbus, the Afrocentric Personal Development Shop, which is now 34 years old, is still there, and the Tawi Family Village. All of those things were a direct outcome, and some of the same people who were involved in some of the activities around them, like for Nzinga, for example, is one of the students who was involved in the in activities there at OSU around that time. And so it has a long history that still exists in Columbus, and one that I think that we need to pay a particular attention to across our cities, and even now here in Atlanta, I will tell you that I'm using some of the same tactics to try and organize something called the Pittsburgh Collaborative. So I think that it's it has had a tremendous impact. If I may have gotten my college degree in understanding how important it is to do that type of thing during that period of time. So that's a little bit that I can tell you. If you ask other questions, maybe I can speak more specifically.
Okay, well, you mentioned when we talked before, I have a statement, you said that Linda McKinley High School played a major role in demanding better conditions and learning for Black students. And so I wondered if you could comment on that.
Well, I think that action demanded that there's that action take place in the Columbus Public Schools. And one thing I did mention that was really our direct outgrowth of that was the Columbus Afrocentric School. Rather than put the courses in all of the high schools, they created a Columbus Afrocentric School. And you probably, it's worth noting that school was started with K through middle school through high school. And it lasted a very long time. It began to deteriorate, and I think it began to deteriorate because of the support that might have been maintained was not from the community, But those are the types of things that I, when I say that it had an impact across the community, including and it also brought Black principal to the unit to Linda. So those types of things happened as a result of that day and subsequent days.
Okay. Well, thank you. Now, I'd like to ask you, having had that experience and the other experiences that you had in Columbus as an activist, when you look at the recent events, social and political events in the United States, say within the past couple of years specifically, what comes to mind? What are your thoughts? Do you see the parallels? Do you see cycles repeating? What are your thoughts on the current state of racial and social justice in this country?
Well, I think that I don't think it has changed. It's changed forms, and the honesty of even the honesty of the segregated. You know, from segregation to desegregation, there's not the honesty of what really exists. The systems that were in place are still in place to make sure that that justice doesn't occur with the Black community. And so we see gentrification occurring where Black people have histories that they need to be maintained and uplifted. And so gentrification seems to be the common answer. We see injustices by police, and police brutality is almost the same as it existed then. We see, it reminds me that there's a greater need now for two things. One is a greater need for unity among us, so that we don't go begging for things, but rather through our action, demanding things that things take place, and demanding of ourselves to have that unity. And then the second one is to, now this is sort of a philosophical one that I want to put before all of us, is that get rid of that notion of let's agree to disagree, and let's make the goal be agree to agree. Now, that's a hard one, because we've been so taught and so individualism has been highly prized so long until it becomes very difficult to change that philosophy so that when you and I and others like us meet together, that we are aiming for agreeing to agree rather than being the big chief and so forth. So I'm just saying, these are some of the things, the lessons that I think that we sometimes overlook and fail to put into place so that we can improve the quality of life for all of us.
Thank you. That's really interesting, particularly the point you made about how deeply entrenched individualism is. And you know, I've read quite a bit just within the past year specifically of people kind of observing how that individualism that is so characterized as American has led us to such a great degree of injustice at this point in time, even in the 21st century. And it's, you know, it's kind of used Well, anyway, I won't get off into that. The last thing I want to ask you then, is how the events at Linda McKinley affected you at the time, and if those events affected you afterward.
Well, they affected me. It made me more committed to do things. I mentioned that it made me serious about demonstrating the possibility of organizing. The African Center for Study and Worship is one of the direct, almost one of the direct outcomes of being motivated to do that as a result of things like Linda McKinley, not just Linda McKinley alone, but other things similar to that took place in the immediate environment there in Columbus. And And it brought together 12 people, that we call the Council of 12, that represented people who had been in prison, that represented people who had PhDs, that represented people who were from the Nation of Islam and other religions and so forth, together to do something, which I believe is what we must do. And so I still remember that so clearly. And that's part of the reason why I say, let's don't beg for things. Let's pull together our strengths, and that pulling together our strengths will demand that we get justice, and there will be no choice. We have not come to, I don't think that that position is operative enough across the nation. Certainly there are some of us who believe that very strongly. And I'm glad that you're doing this specifically for Columbus. And I hope that as it's done for Columbus, this documentary, not just what I'm saying, but what others have said too, that they can look at it and learn from that a little bit goes a long way, much further than we think when we take action, much further than just conversation.
Right. Thank you so much. Thank you for saying that, but also thank you for being a part of this. We really appreciate your voice and your perspective. It's priceless, really, honestly.